sounds like you're making a firm bet against the critics of artificial intelligence who say that in theory it's philosophically impossible to replicate human intelligence.
I see their arguments as faulty, and I don't see that human intelligence is something that humans can never understand.
John McCarthy was the legendary great who founded the Stanford Artificial Intelligence Laboratory.
I remember John McCarthy would always challenge me to think deeper about a problem, broader about a problem, advance it more. He was the kind of individual that would have that deep kind of intellectual engagement.
And the naming of artificial intelligence is normally attributed to John McCarthy organizing a summer conference at Dartmouth in the 1950s.
There wasn't even a computer science department yet when I got here. It was just a program. And I started working with John McCarthy, and I did my thesis in AI. It was on a program to play chess in games. In those days, chess was a killer app for AI.
That there was at the very beginning this idea that we should have computers that can learn from the world around them in the same way that human beings so obviously learn. But perhaps that seemed too difficult a goal at the time. People got much more interested in symbol systems and reasoning and the idea that we wanted to build formal models of knowledge and how to reason with systems. And that became the mainstay of artificial intelligence through the 60s, 70s, and 80s.
When I arrived at Stanford in 1965, the theme of the first generation of AI was largely a pursuit of generality in the models of cognition.
And Stanford was a leader in that area, that we were in many ways the home of using formal logical inference.
Well, Stanford was one of the early pioneers in artificial intelligence. Even when I arrived in the 70s, it was already a hotbed of research.
I was working on a robot called Shaky. Shaky had several programs, some for dealing with perception. We had machine vision programs, for example, and some controlled Shaky's actions as it moved around in its environment. Richard Fikes and I developed a system we called STRIPS, for Stanford Research Institute Problem Solver. Those of us who were involved in the development of A-Star and STRIPS are gratified now to know that these systems are used in many present-day AI applications.
So when I got here in 73, it was really an amazing place. They had set up the artificial intelligence lab in this circular, wooden, modernistic building a mile up in the hills above the campus.
I get the sense that it was a seriously playful place. But really, at the same time, it was pioneering things like computer music. And there was a room in the AI lab dedicated to computer music research where John Chowning worked at night. And in John's words, it was as to not abuse our hosts.
There was this energy of people doing just all kinds of projects. There was this huge robot arm that filled one room, that picking things up, moving them. There was a cart that rolled around the countryside, around the building.
At Stanford, we have been interested in man-machine voice communication. Our work is based on the analysis and classification of speech waves. For the purpose of analysis, we break down each utterance into quasi-linguistic units.
How are you?
The work that I was doing at that time in understanding language by computer, I always tell people it's the great-great-great-great-grand ancestor of Siri.
The second decade of AI's work came to be dominated by these programs.
Expert systems are programs for which the intent of the designer is that the program exhibit expert level competence or beyond expert level competence.
At Stanford University Medical Center, an expert system called OncoSyn is under development in a collaboration between oncologists and a group of medical AI researchers headed by Dr. Edward Shortliff.
OncoSyn is utilized to manage patients with lymphomas and Hodgkin's disease and breast cancer. It takes information about the patient and then gives advice to the physician managing the patient.
One of the characteristics of medicine is that you never tend to know absolutely anything. When expert systems and really solid decision support systems are integrated into the data management environment, that a computer could really help the delivery of healthcare and hopefully the quality of care, perhaps even lower the cost of care, you find yourself encountering some of the most basic issues in artificial intelligence research.
There are several ways we're exploring this issue. One is by asking programs to discover new knowledge for themselves. Another is by asking programs to discover new knowledge from large databases by induction.
One of the first robot programming system was developed at Stanford. We get a lot of inspiration from the human. What we are trying to do is to understand what is behind this motion. How can we encode that strategy in something that the robot can use so we can generalize?
It's rolling the object between two fingers while maintaining a stable grasp.
In the 80s when I arrived, but it was an amazing dynamic environment. You can see Romeo and Juliet. These are the two platforms that we developed to explore the workspace of a human. If we are really to think about robots that would interact with human, we would need to have those robots not fixed, but mobile. We started to look at mobile manipulation and all kinds of things that were amazingly interesting to analyze and work on.
Throughout the 90s, the field of AI gravitated more and more to adopt statistical machine learning techniques around problems that emerge from the physical world. Robotics and computer vision and language, which are all areas where one encounters natural data that comes at you from sensors. That was a place where the traditional AI techniques that relied on logic really failed to sort of deal with the noise and uncertainty and ambiguity. I was fortunate to be able to come into an environment that had an incredibly strong reputation in the field of artificial intelligence, driven by people like Ed and John and others, but also at a time of opportunity because there were some incredible young people who were emerging in other parts of the world as graduate students that were more representative of the new style of AI. But because we were looking to sort of expand the group and rebuild it, there was the opportunity to bring them in and hire amazing young colleagues like Sebastian Thron and Andrew Ng and Fei-Fei Li and Chris Manning and others to really create a department that turned out to be one of the strongest departments, arguably maybe the strongest department in the world in this new style of AI. One of the things that came out of this effort on dealing with the realities of physical systems, systems that are embedded in the real world, was Sebastian Thron's work and that of others on Stanley.
Which was the first time that there was this successful autonomous car. So it was a defining project that brought a lot of people together across different groups. But then a second revolution started, this new approach of building artificial neural networks. That was something that was first tried in the 1950s, and it was tried again in the 1980s. And indeed, one of the most prominent people from the 1980s work is Jay McClelland.
Then I think of Andrew Ng being one of those who pursued neural network ideas during the period when they were less popular.
Researchers call this technique machine learning, to let a computer learn by itself.
The first big success of deep learning happened in vision. ImageNet was a project that we carried out in 2006, where my students and I collecting a internet scale data set of diverse objects and images, we can refocus the algorithm development of computer vision tasks towards that real world scenario.
When combined with neural networks, the scale of ImageNet made it possible for machines to achieve human-like recognition of objects for the first time. And that combination formed the basis of a whole world of deep learning applications.
Stanford became in the 2000s the leading lab for doing natural language processing research. We started to have this new era of deep learning-based speech recognition systems. What we'd like to be able to do is have computers that have the same kind of ability to understand and learn. Human language is like the networking layer of the societal mind.
For a long time, natural language processing, NLP, was focused on really hard problems of understanding and translating sentences. Now, the people side of language as a technology is much more relevant.
Ocean One is bringing a new capability for underwater exploration.
This was a wonderful example of the kind of things that you can do once you have autonomous machines that can provide new capabilities that can augment what humans can do in exploring the planet.
Stanford had an incredible leadership role in the marriage of machine learning and biology and health that has been tremendously impactful in reshaping the field of biology. How do we take biological data, medical data, and use the kind of statistical modeling techniques that were developed more broadly within AI and machine learning to try and make sense and extract significant insights about human biology?
Fei-Fei and Olga believe it was really a societal imperative to be looking at an artificial intelligence that responds to the needs and interests of the many, not only a subset of society.
In order to train AI to benefit humanity, the creators of AI need to represent humanity.
I think AI for All has been a part of the vision to really embrace a wider community in the development of artificial intelligence.
One of the things I love about Stanford is there is a critical mass of women researchers in the Stanford AI lab leading research at the faculty level, as well as at being graduate students and undergraduate students.
Having been involved in the field of artificial intelligence for a long time, Stanford has had the benefit of training many of the researchers around the world who are going on to really push the field forward. And that's helped spread this discipline.
So many inventions and startups and big companies coming out of this place. And the reason for this is because Stanford creates this place where people dare things and go for the big ideas.
The best thinking, the wild new ideas just come from having really smart people with an opportunity to think about what could be done and what should be done.
I just look at colleagues and the overall spirit of the community for examples of that kind of daring leadership.
When you bring together great students and great faculty, marvelous things can happen.